Okay, so welcome to calculus. So today is the 21st, which means it's the solstice, or the day after the solstice, depending on what happened this year. What's the solstice, by the way? The beginning of summer, and it is the longest day of the year. The day with the most amount of sunlight. Okay, so then let's have some examples. So right now, we're still at the last place that we were last time in 8.1. Which was what was 8.1? By parts. Okay, so then how about, for example, so my first question, is this an antiderivative or is it an integral?
Antiderivative.
It's an antiderivative. Or if you like that other terminology, is this an indefinite integral or a definite integral? It's indefinite. Okay. But I'll keep saying antiderivative. As a result, our final answer, are we expecting it to be a function or a number?
Function.
A function. Should be a function. And there will there be plus C or no plus C-ness?
Plus C.
There will be a plus C. Okay. So what kind of technique do we need to use?
U-substitution.
A U substitution. Okay. And it... The context may be a little bit lost, but if this minute of the course came exactly after the last minute of the last lecture, then we would have been doing by parts for like an hour. Okay, and you would be in a sense primed to try and use integration by parts for this one. So the reason why I'm saying that is because in the future, when I give you antiderivatives and integrals, I'm not going to say what it is you're supposed to be doing. I'm not going to say you need to use this technique or that technique. It's not going to occur. So what you must do is you must make that determination on your own. So we've been saying the procedure for some time now, but now we're going to give it a name. And its name is the Riesz procedure. So what is the first step in the procedure? Well, whenever we're doing an antiderivative, I always ask the same question. I say the top of the procedure. So what's the very first thing I ask? Is it exactly one of the antiderivatives that we know? Right? So is this a known antiderivative?
No.
It's not, right? Right. Now, so yes, I think you meant, did you know how to do it? Okay, fine. But it's not one of the known ones. Remember, the known ones in our class are u to n du, 1 over u du, and e to u du. So in our class, there's just these three known ones. In the wide world, there's many known ones. Okay, so then this is not one of the known antiderivatives. Oh, my red pens. Where'd it go? I did just have, oh, here it is right here. Just blind.
Oh, you put the cap on it.
Yeah, that's what got me, yeah. Okay, so what's the next step in the Riesch procedure? There's something even before that. Algebraic. Is there an algebraic manipulation? So can you do some kind of algebraic trick to turn it into one of these? Okay, so how about that on this one?
No.
So the answer is yes and no.
Well, yes, but I don't want to.
Right, good. I agree with that. Yes, but I don't want to. Why yes?
Because you could boil it out 8 times, but...
Yes, you could actually multiply out this product. In principle, you could. And in fact, you don't want to even attempt that, right? Okay, so then what's the third step? Now, here's where substitution comes in. Okay, so then on this one, can you do a substitution?
Yes.
Okay, but let's pretend for just a moment that we couldn't. Then what's the fourth step in the Riesch procedure? Now it's by parts. Okay, so does everyone see that in the procedure, the Riesch procedure, where we exit on this particular exercise is we say, ah, yes, we can do a substitution. Okay, so then u is x squared plus 5. And then what is the consequence of u that we need?
du.
So du is what?
2x squared.
Good. And then when we do that, what is the new antiderivative?
U to the 8. Oh, antiderivative.
Yeah, what's the new one? So after the substitution, it'll be what?
U to 8 du.
Right, u to 8 du.
U to 8 du, sorry.
Right, because u covers the stuff in the parentheses and du covers everything else. And so now, here, we have significantly altered the antiderivative that we started with, which means that we start back at the top of the Riesch procedure. So is this one of the known antiderivatives?
Yes.
Ah, it's right there. So does everybody see the way it works? It's just continually apply this. So then this would be u to 9 over 9, and then plus a constant. And then is this the answer to the exercise?
No.
Why not?
Because you have to plug back in the substitution.
Very good. So this would be, after substituting back, x squared plus 5 to 9, divide by 9, plus a constant. Any question about this opener? Okay.
Wait, so we don't do anything with 2x?
Yes, we did do something with 2x, specifically, that this red x stuff became this red u stuff. And then this green differential stuff, dx stuff, became this green differential stuff, du. So it became, all of this green became du. And all of this red became u. So u to 8 du. And then that's a known antiderivative, right? It is u to n plus 1 divide by n plus 1 plus a constant. So then when we got to this position with n is 8, then the answer became u to 9 divided by 9 plus a constant.
So does it mean you just drop off?
It does just drop off, yes.
Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Other questions? Okay. So So how about antiderivative of, say, 4x e to 5x dx. So what do you think? U is e to 5x? I don't think this will work. So let's think about this for a minute. So we'll start at the top of the procedure, right? Is this a known antiderivative?
No.
It's not a known one. Okay. Is there some algebra we can do? Not really, right? In a sense, the best we could do is we could take that factor the 4 out of the antiderivative. But let's just leave it there because that's not doing anything anyway. Okay, can we do a substitution? Okay, so it seems like there's some desire to do a U substitution. So let's see what that would do. And U is 5x was the request?
Yeah.
So if U is 5x, then du would be 5dx. So that du over 5 is dx. So that'd be enough to cover everything except what?
X.
Except x. So how could we fix, how could we cover that? Right, we could take this one and solve for x, right? So that u over 5 is x. And if we were to do that over here, say, that would be now antiderivative 4 and then u over 5 and then e to u and then du over 5. So over 5 would be 25, so that'd be 4 over 25.
It's not better.
Right, I agree it's not any better. It's not any better, but sometimes it can be hard to see that it's not any better until you write it down. Mm-hmm. Okay, but does everyone see that in the end, this antiderivative right here is slightly simpler than that one because there's no more fours and fives. Okay, but they're really basically just the same. So that substitution is not going to work. And there's really nothing else much to substitute. So then if not substitution, then what's the next step in the Riesz procedure?
Integration
by parts. Okay, so let's make that attempt. So 4x and e to 5x dx. So what do you need to do for by parts? Lay an egg. Okay, good. So then let's label each part. So what is this part?
Algebraic.
This is algebraic. And then this part is what?
Exponential.
An egg. Exponential. So between A and E, which one comes first in the acronym?
A.
A comes first, lay an egg. Okay, as a result, that tells us what?
That U is 4x.
U is 4x, very good. And even better than that, it also tells us what dv is. What's dv?
E to the 5x.
Right, it's always everything else. So e to 5x dx. And then, how many symbols are in the by parts formula?
Four.
Presently, we have two. And the other two are a consequence of these two. So, what can we get from U that we need?
Dv.
We can get du. So du is what? 4dx. And what can we get from dv that we need? V. And how do we get v from dv?
The antiderivative.
Very good. And so now, at this position, this is one of the moments of truth for a biparts attempt. Because now we've traded an antiderivative that we couldn't deal with directly for this one. So can we do this one?
Yes.
Yes, we can. So what is the antiderivative of e to 5x dx?
E to 5x over 5.
Very good. I agree that if this was the exercise.
Oh, yes, we don't do a plus c here, sorry.
Right. So there's no plus c here because we're not quite finished anti-differentiating yet. Okay, so then the right-hand side of biparts is uv minus antiderivative vdu. So now we plug everything in. So that'd be 4x e to 5x over 5 minus antiderivative e to 5x over 5, 4dx. Okay, so now in biparts, in the integration by parts technique, you're trading the antiderivative that you can't deal with directly for actually two other antiderivatives. You're trading it for this one and also this one. So you're trading the one that you might not be able to deal with for two others. And so you have to, in a sense, always check, well, could I proceed here? Yes. Can I proceed here? Well, can we?
Yes.
Yes, we can, right? So if we factor this out, this would be 4x and then e to 5x over 5 minus 4/5 antiderivative of e to 5x dx. So is that one of the known antiderivatives?
Yes.
Ah, it is one of the known antiderivatives. So 4x e to 5x over 5 minus 4/5 e to 5x over another 5 plus a constant. Any question about this exercise? That's the answer to the exercise. Other questions? Okay. Yes?
You're okay with us leaving. I guess we have to leave E because we don't know X. So, just kidding.
Okay. Other questions?
You got the 4 over 5 because of 4 dx.
Right. This. Yes.
Okay.
Other questions? Okay. How about. How about x, now we'll make it something interesting. How about 8x and then divided by 3x squared plus 5 dx. And then I'm going to make it an integral, so how about 2 to 10? So is this an antiderivative or an integral?
An integral.
Right. Okay, good. So Are we expecting the answer to be a function or a number?
A number.
A number. Right. Is it going to be plus c or is there no plus c?
No plus c.
No plus c, right? Okay, now. So this is an integral and there's not going to be plus c going around, but nevertheless, we will still compute an antiderivative, right? And why is that?
Because
that we're still going to end up computing an antiderivative. I agree that somehow there's a relationship to area. But I'd like for you to recall that the first time we ever computed an integral was the most painful thing you may have ever done, right? We cut a region into rectangles and then computed areas of rectangles and then added them up and then said, now let's imagine that there's infinitely many rectangles and we computed a limit. Remember that. We're not going to do that.
Yeah.
We're not going to do that here. Somehow we're going to end up using an antiderivative. What allows us to use an antiderivative? The fundamental theorem of calculus. Right? So the reason why I'm saying that is because typically when students exit this course, they mistakenly believe that the fundamental theorem of calculus is what an integral is. It's not. An integral is cutting a region into infinitely many pieces and then summing things up. That's what an integral is. The fundamental theorem of calculus is saying that if you have an antiderivative, then you don't have to do that procedure at all. You can just evaluate that antiderivative at two places and subtract. And it's really just maybe not too much to say the most fundamental theorem in all of science. Calculus for sure. Okay. So that being said, we're going to use the fundamental theorem, which means we need to evaluate this antiderivative. So is this a known antiderivative?
No.
It's not a known one. Is there something algebraic we can do to turn it into a known one?
No.
So, in particular, because the plus is in the denominator, that means you can't do any distribution. If the plus was in the numerator, you could do some distribution, but because it's in the denominator, you cannot. Okay, so then what's the next thing on the list? Substitution. Okay, can we do one? Can we do a substitution? Okay, so I have a vote for doesn't look good. Outcome not clear, come back later.
Right. Well, I think if you factor out the 8,
factor out an 8?
We can't right now.
Okay, we could factor out that 8. So just momentarily, let's imagine that the 8's not there. Then what would you do? Okay, well, let's just do that. So U is? Right.
What I was thinking.
Good. So if you were thinking something, that's good if you had some idea, but.
If I was thinking.
I mean, that's good, but in the end.
Questionable sometimes.
All I'm trying to say is that please, don't imagine. Imagine a little bit, but when you've imagined something and you think it might work, start writing it down, because it really, really helps to write something down. It's not a good strategy to try and imagine your way all the way to the end. So, what is du? 6x dx. Okay, so then do we have 6x dx? No, but we have an x dx, so we could divide by 6. I was thinking 8 and then wrote 8. I meant to write 6. Okay, so x dx. So then, what do we have covered so far? Right, all this stuff is covered by U. What do we have covered by DU? X dx, right? It's covered by DU over 6. Okay, the limits. Let's deal with the limits for a second. So what do we need to do to figure out the limits?
Calculate U at 10 and 2.
Okay, good. So you evaluated at 2. So plug in 2 here, that'd be 17. And you evaluated at 10. That'd be a lot, 305. Okay, so then these numbers are enough to cover the limits. And I think your initial objection was essentially, now that we've done all of this, notice what's uncovered. 8's not covered. And you might be concerned about that. So some people say, well, just factor it out. Okay, I agree. But I'll also say this. What we're doing is we're trying to figure out, well, we're doing a substitution. We're changing X's for U's. And we're saying that, well, what if these X's were a U? Then this differential thing in X would be this differential thing in U and these other things. So I have a question for you. What is 8 equal to when U is equal to 3X squared plus 5?
What?
It's 8. Right. What is 8 equal to when the dinosaurs were walking the earth? 8, right? What is 8 equal to when it's raining?
9.
Right? It's 8. It doesn't care about the substitution at all. It really doesn't care. So it just becomes itself. So this would be integral 17 to 305. This 8 stays an 8. This thing on the bottom becomes a u, and this x dx becomes du over 6.
But wouldn't we just keep the 8 on the other side? The integral thing? We don't need to keep it where it exists.
If you wanted it over here,
so if we did that first,
then just leave it over there. It doesn't matter. Okay, so then I'll factor out the 8 over 6. Okay, so now we have significantly changed the antiderivative, the corresponding antiderivative. And so that means we need to start back at the top of the Riesz procedure and ask ourselves, is this one of the known antiderivatives?
Yes.
Oh, it is. Okay. And 8 over 6 is 4 over 3. So 4 over 3. And then log absolute u. Evaluate from 17 to 305. So this would be 4 over 3. Log of 305 minus log of 17. And I dropped the absolute value. Why is that? Yeah, because they're positive. And then you could, you know, if this was an exercise, I might say evaluate this to 3 places past the decimal. So would you please, if you have a calculator, please do that to make sure, as a test, that you can operate your calculator under duress. And I'll use just a short little trick here. Right, so then the difference of logs is the log of the quotient, right? That's one of the log rules. And at least on my calculator, it's slightly shorter to type this. Yes. And my calculator is reporting to me 3.849.
Did you ever ask for that on the test?
Yes. Yes?
So if we didn't want to redo, like if we go back to not evaluating the limits at
this?
Yeah, so let's say we didn't do that, we kept it at U.
Okay.
And we go all the way down to mm-hmm. where we get the LN of U,
mm-hmm.
and we substitute it back with a 3x² + 5.
Yes.
And we keep the original limits,
mm-hmm.
and we solve that way, that still was the same answer, right?
Yes. So, to summarize, your question was,
I don't have to do that if I don't want to.
Right, is that if you don't change the limits, if you leave them as x, and then at the end resubstitute x's for u's, and then plug in the x's, the answer will be the same.
Okay.
However, I will also say, statistically speaking, it's my experience that students who take that strategy are statistically less likely to score high. Like, there's a statistical difference. Now, I'm not saying that's you or any person in particular. I'm saying that as a group, the group that takes the strategy of substituting the limits appears to score higher than the group that doesn't.
All right.
Okay. So it's not a specific comment to you. It's just.
But to answer my question, yes.
Yes. The answer is that the answers must be the same. Other questions? Okay. So how about integral from 1 to 2 of x log x dx. What do you think?
And it's not when we know we can't do algebra.
So. I agree. The first two steps are out. It's not a known antiderivative. There's nothing algebraic to do.
So if you do u substitution, du is equal to 1 over x dx, which we don't have. And
right.
I don't know how to solve that.
Right.
Which is
yeah, so there's, I agree. So I think you're saying, what if we had a u sub attempt and said u is log of x, then du would be 1 over x dx. Well, we don't have 1 over x dx. We have x dx.
Right.
So it's just not going to work.
Okay. So I guess we have to move on to the question.
Okay, but that's good, right? To know that by parts is the fourth line of resort. Like, okay, I guess this means that we're gonna do this by parts. Okay, and that is what's necessary for this exercise, is to do it by parts. Okay, so this one doesn't work, right? Yeah, it's concave down there, that's right. So by parts then, which means that if we're going to do that, we need to label the individual factors. So what's the label for this one? Algebraic. And what's the label for the other one? Log. Okay, so then as a result we can make a conclusion about what u should be. So what should u be?
LN.
Log. So u is log of x, and as a result what is dv?
X
dx, right? Because dv is always everything else. Okay, so how many quantities are in the biparts formula?
Four.
Presently we have how many?
Two.
The other two are a consequence of these two. So which one is the consequence of U?
Du.
So that'd be 1 over x dx. And which one is the consequence of dv? V, right? So v, how do we get v from dv? Antiderivative. So antiderivative of x dx is x squared over 2. And no plus c at this juncture. Okay, so then, so as a result of this, the right-hand side of biparts is uv minus antiderivative v du. However, this is not right. Why is this not right?
You're forgetting your 2 and 1?
Yes. Okay, which is to say that it, as it's written, this is understood to mean that this thing is equal to that thing. And that can't be right as it's currently written, because what kind of thing is it, did we start with?
An integral.
An integral. And what is this? An antiderivative. This cannot possibly be right. Okay. Integrals and antiderivatives are related through the fundamental theorem, but they're not the same thing. So to make this right, we have to add the limits. So this is this thing evaluated from 1 to 2, and this integral from 1 to 2. So this line without the red bits that I just wrote was not correct. Okay, so any question about that? Because the previous exercise where we did use integration by parts, it was an antiderivative. It was not an integral. Okay? So now, plug things in. So uv log x times x squared over 2. This evaluated from 1 to 2 minus integral 1 to 2 of v du. So that'd be x squared over 2 times 1 over x dx. So then we'll evaluate this in a moment. But as for this, how are we going to handle this?
Factor out 1/2.
Okay. I agree that we can factor out the half, but then we still have x squared times 1 over x.
So then it's just x.
Ah, right. We can algebraically simplify this, right?
Yes.
And that's what we must do. So log x, x squared over 2, evaluated from 1 to 2. Minus half integral 1 to 2 of x dx. Okay, and then for this one, right, the antiderivative corresponding to this one through the fundamental theorem, is this one of the antiderivatives that we know?
Yes.
Yes. Log of x, x squared over 2, evaluate from 1 to 2, minus half, and then this would be x squared over 2, from 1 to 2. And now there's nothing left to do but evaluate. So let's do it. So this first one will be log 2 times 4 over 2. Minus log 1 times 1 over 2. Okay, then minus, I'll factor out that half there. That'd be a fourth. And then 4 minus 1. So this half and that half are in product, and that's where the 1/4 is.
What happened to the x squared?
And then the x squared, I plugged in 2 into x squared, which is...
Oh, I see.
No,
right.
If you plug 2 into x squared over... not over 2. You factored that out.
Right, I factored it out.
I apologize.
No problem. So how about this one? What is this, log of 1?
0.
0, right? So this would be, this one would be log of 2 times 2. That's all that remains of the first set of parentheses, and then minus 3 over 4.
Can you move the 2 in front or no?
Yes, this 2, if it feels better for you for it to be in front, by all means. Other questions about this? Okay. So, one thing I want to illustrate, because the other class seemed to ask about it repeatedly, is, if I can find one. Okay, so do you have this one? Okay. Here's an example. X into X. Okay. So integral 0 to log 2 of x e to x dx. So This part in the previous exercise, the other class seemed to really not like this. This was quite disturbing to them for some reason. Okay, well, it's possible to how do I say it? So this procedure is like doing two things at the same time, like juggling 5 balls. But maybe it's easier just to juggle
just
3 balls or just 1 ball, which is how many I can juggle. Right. So it's possible to do this sort of one piece at a time, which is to say, okay, what were we given? Were we given an integral to do or an antiderivative to do?
Integral.
An integral. And we're going to use the fundamental theorem to evaluate this integral, which means that we're going to have to evaluate an antiderivative. So we can do the antiderivative first and say, okay, I see that we're doing an integral, but first I'm going to do the antiderivative. Okay, so then just the antiderivative first. Which is to say, now this is what we're considering. Not the integral, but the antiderivative. And then now we're going to do the Riesz procedure. Is this one of the known antiderivatives? No. Is there something algebraic we can do? No. Is there a substitution we can do? No. So then it must be a by parts exercise. That's an A. This is an E. Lay an egg, right? Which one comes first? A comes first.
Lay an egg. A comes first, right?
A comes first.
A is an apple.
As an apple.
Okay, sorry, that's okay.
So then that means that U is x, and dv is everything else. So e to x dx. And I know I'm rushing through this one, but it's just to illustrate a point. So du is a consequence of u. V, the antiderivative of e to x, is e to x. Then the right-hand side of by parts is uv minus antiderivative v du. So is it supposed to be antiderivative, or is it supposed to be integral, or?
We were doing the antiderivative first.
Yeah. Right. So I explicitly said, well, I'm going to do the antiderivative first. So that's what I'm doing. I'm doing the antiderivative first. So this would be x e to x minus antiderivative e to x dx. So x e to x minus e to x plus a constant. So we computed the antiderivative. Now why is that helpful?
Well, I'm assuming now we can just evaluate it at log of 2 and 0.
Right. So now,
why would that not be easier?
Now we're going to invoke the fundamental theorem and say that, well, according to the fundamental theorem, x e to x dx from 0 to log 2 will be this thing evaluated from 0 to log 2. So x e to x minus e to x, and then I'll drop the plus c, and then 0 to log 2. So in a sense, what this is saying is that this is just a different way to organize the exercise to say that, well, I'm going to do only the antiderivative part here and only the evaluation here. Okay.
It's just, it's less arithmetic at the end to screw up, because that's where I generally screw up, is the arithmetic at the end.
The amount of arithmetic is the same. It's just the location
where you're
doing it.
Yes.
It's just the location. But it depends on how people like to organize their thoughts.
But the answer is going to be the same either way.
It will be the same either way. This?
Yes.
Well, this is applying anti-differentiation by parts. Okay. Well, it just takes practice, right? It's just like anything else. I don't know how to juggle. But I don't think that there's inherently something wrong with me. I think that if I was to
not
practice,
you can't juggle.
yeah, not in the juggling sense, right? Because I think that if I was to practice juggling for a semester, I surely could. By the end. So then, plugging this in.
So.
Log 2.
We put log 2 in the first one.
Yes, log 2 e to log 2.
And then subtract 0, and then put it into 0.
Minus e to log 2, like this. So that's evaluating at log 2. And then minus, evaluate it at 0. So that'd be 0 times e to 0 minus e to 0. Okay.
Wait a second.
All right.
It all
looks, So what is e to log 2? It's 2, right? The exponential of the logarithm of 2 is 2. So that's log 2 times 2, and then minus 2. And then 0 times e to 0 is 0. And then what's e to 0?
1.
So this would be plus 1 after distributing the subtraction. So that would be log 2 times 2, minus 1. Mm-hmm. Any question about this one?
Is it a good way to practice this? Like,
different?
Because, like, we get to the home.
Mm-hmm.
So I found...
Is there a...
Oh, sorry. I found that the math lab really helps, and I, the hours suck, but...
That's why.
The other thing I found is that there's some online... I wrote it down. It's somebody's online tools, and they have, like, step-by-step problems. And so you can see if there's one, and then they'll kind of work one that's similar to yours, and then you can kind of see how it's done.
Okay.
I wrote it down, but I can't remember the name of it, but I'll find it before the next class.
Another good strategy, I think, maybe the best strategy, is to attempt some exercises and write them down and come to my office. And then show me what you have, and then I'll fairly quickly be able to figure out where the gaps in your knowledge may be. And I'll be happy to go back and forth until we get it worked out. Yes? So during my office hours, you're welcome to come in at any time. You don't need to... Well, so I think you're meaning, what if you want to schedule time that's not during my listed office hours? Just, it'll be on a per case basis. If it sounds like you're going to need 30 minutes, then 30 minutes. If it sounds like an hour, then an hour. But do understand that I'm a single parent of two children, and my children are presently being babysat, and I will leave quite quickly to get them. So the evening hours, if I schedule office hours with you, please come prepared, because that means that I've hired a babysitter. Okay?
Can you put the problem back on board? I just wanted to ask you a question. So when we're doing the other part, we would insert limits after x, e to the x, and then the limit minus, no, up. The other way.
This one?
No.
This one?
Further up.
Oh, up here, okay. Zero to log two. Are you asking how would this exercise be solved in the other way?
Yeah, would I at that one step right there?
Okay, let's just write that down. I'm not seeing. Okay, so here's the same exercise, except now I'm going to do it very quickly now. So zero to log two x e to x dx. Okay, I can see that it should be by parts, so u is x, dv is e to x dx, du is dx, v is e to x. Okay, so it's just the same as before. So then the right-hand side of by parts is uv minus integral v du, and what's important to understand is because we're not doing it in that split strategy where we're doing the antiderivative first, because we're not taking that strategy, then this is not right. What's not right about this? Yeah, we need the limits. So this would be 0 to log 2. 0 to log 2. So now it's right. And this would be x e to x from 0 to log 2 minus integral 0 to log 2 e to x dx. So then this would be log 2 e to log 2 minus 0 e to 0, and then minus the antiderivative of e to x is e to x, and then this would be 0 to log 2 Yes, is this okay? Okay. So this would be log 2, e to log 2 is 2, so log 2 times 2, minus 0, and then minus, here I'll make an error, minus e to log of 2, minus e to 0. What's wrong with this? Right, because it's minus this thing, so minus all of this, which is to say, yes, these parentheses. And without those red parentheses, that's e to 0 is 1. Formerly it said we're going to subtract 1, but now it's saying we're going to add 1. Okay, so then this would be log 2, and then minus 0, I'll ignore that, then minus 2 minus 1. So 2 minus 1 is 1, so minus 1. And this 2 I didn't write. So log 2 times 2 minus 1.
So either way you're
doing the same
answer?
Yes. Mm-hmm. This one we're doing the antiderivative alone. There's two separate things that have to occur.
No, I understand. I just now I see it. So instead of doing it all together like you did on the right, you're separating it and doing it like two.
Right. Correct. Yes?
If I have to do one thing on my quiz, when I have to write, I'm doing the antiderivative first. Now I'm doing the rest of it, or
as long as it's clear to the grader that you have not confused the distinction between an integral and an antiderivative. So, I disagree because mathematics is like, it's like writing an essay for your literature class. And you might say that, well, you know, I correctly understood that Voldemort was the bad guy. But if you didn't write your sentences correctly, you didn't use the right correct sentence structure, then your answer is still not right. Okay? So understand that this course and these ideas, it's not about trying to get to this number. This number is almost irrelevant. It's the procedure of you doing it. I suppose, yes, that's the answer. Just make it abundantly clear to the grader that that's what you're doing. The grader has a degree, nearly a PhD in math in each case. So they're perfectly well-versed in all of this. But they're told that they need to make sure, they need to remember, you know, back in the day when they were learning this, and they need to imagine whether or not they believe that you are well-versed in this. Okay? So leave no doubt to the grader is what I'm saying. Other questions? Okay. So any questions before we go to something new? A different topic. It is the anti-product rule. By parts is the anti-product rule.
More different types of by parts?
No. That's the entirety of it.
That's it?
Yes.
That's great. Okay.
Once you've decided that you're going to do by parts, then you label each of the factors as coming from category L, category A, or category E. Logs, algebraic, or exponential. No, except for quotients that can be written. Okay.
Oh, no.
Let's just do one.
Is the simplification of the question, is there a quotient, anti-quotient rule,
yes,
as there is an anti-product
yes,
there is an anti-product
that was my question.
Rule?
There's no such thing as an anti-quotient rule.
Okay.
However.
However.
Just Just to muddy the waters a little bit more.
So here is a quotient.
So you would just turn it into a, you would just turn the derivative around -1.5 and do it that way.
Well, let's see what happens.
No,
we're gonna see. We're gonna do it.
Like -1.5.
Here, let's make it easier so that it doesn't take so much time.
Thanks.
Now it's slightly easier, so it doesn't take so much time. Okay, so.
Why would we not just do u sub?
Okay, so that's, can you say that a little louder?
Why would we not just do u sub?
Okay.
Because that's probably what I would do.
So, now, there is definitely a way to do this with a u substitution, and this can also be done with, by parts. It could be done in both ways. So let's do it both ways. Okay, so I'm going to do it in both ways. I'm going to do it in the left column with a substitution and in the right column with by parts. I can only do it once at a time. So u substitution is the first one I'll try. So if u is x plus 3, so my teacher sense is telling me that at least one person out there is saying, I'm not real sure how that's going to go with the u substitution. So I'm going to give you a minute to try and figure out how it can be done with the substitution. So if this is u, then what's du?
Dx.
So at the present time, that means that this red stuff, this red x plus 3 can be covered by u. And this green dx can be covered by this green du. And this is where some of you, I suspect, are stuck saying, I don't know what to do with that x.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we can solve first.
Yes, this thing.
Oh, so it's -3.
It's not -3. It's u minus 3.
Oh, u minus 3.
Right? Because here's an equation that you can solve for x with. So u minus 3. So this and this. So does everybody see the correspondence now with the substitution? Okay. And you might say, wow, I really don't like this. I'm gonna wait for the by parts. Okay, well, let's see. So then this would be in the numerator u minus 3, and then divide by square root u, du. And you might object and say, wow, this looks just as bad as what we started with. I agree. So then, notice that on the original antiderivative, no algebra could occur. Because in the end, the problem was is that we had a plus hanging out inside of a radical. That was a problem. This substitution, we changed the plus to a minus. That's not a big deal. But notably, look at the position of it. Where is it?
It's in the numerator.
It's in the numerator, and it's not in the radical. That is terrific. Okay, so the real thing that occurred, the important thing that occurred in this substitution, is that the plus got out of the radical, and even, and just as good, out of the denominator. It's now out of the radical and in the numerator. That's what's important about this. So that means that algebraically we can do this now. This is u over square root u minus 3 over square root u. And now we can perform a further algebraic operation. How can we simplify u over square root u? Almost.
It's u to the 1/2.
It is u to 1/2. Yes. And then minus, how can we rewrite this?
3 times u to -1/2.
Right. 3 times u to -1/2. Du. And so now, do we know? Yes. What is it? The power rule for each one, right? So this. Why did this become this? Because u divided by square root u is u to exponent 1 divided by u to exponent 1/2. And when you are dividing things of the same base, what do you do with the exponents?
Subtract.
You subtract. So it's so the new exponent is u to 1 minus 1/2, which is 1/2. So then for this one, the power rule, so this would be u to 3/2 divided by 3/2 minus 3 u to 1/2 divided by 1/2 plus a constant. And then finally, to answer the question, substitute the x's back in. X plus 3 to 3/2 over 3/2 minus 3 x plus 3 to 1/2 over 1/2, and then plus a constant.
Can you explain real quick how you got the u minus 3?
This? So we needed to cover this x, and we had this equation. So in this equation here, solve for x. Okay, so this one is a consequence of this one. Other questions? Okay. So looking at this in another way, so again, just the same antiderivative here. You might say, well, that substitution resolve thingy, I didn't really care for it. Or maybe you didn't notice it could be done with a substitution at all. So that perhaps you want to reckon it as this product. As this product. X and then x plus 3 to -1/2 dx. And maybe you're committed to by parts. Maybe you really like that. Well, let's label it. Label the factors. So what kind of thing is this?
Algebra.
That's algebraic. And what kind of thing is this other one?
Exponential.
Not exponential.
Oh, algebra.
It's also algebraic. So I agree that there is an exponent of -1/2. I agree with that. Nevertheless, this is not an exponential factor, because in order for something to be called exponential, the exponent must be variable. However, the exponent is -1/2, which is a constant.
Okay.
So like x squared, yes, it has an exponent, but it is not exponential. But 2 to x has an exponent, and it is exponential.
That makes sense.
So these are both algebraic, which you know, throws a monkey wrench in our cute little lay an egg thingy, right? So they're both algebraic. So remember that thing is just called a heuristic, which means it's just a good idea. It's not a hard and fast rule. Which means that if you run into such a situation, then now it's time to just guess, is what it comes down to. So
there's not a way to choose a better option.
Well, substitution is going to turn out to be better.
I know, but if we get to this point with another problem, is there not a way to say, oh, this will be better. This one is better than this one.
Other than trying, no.
Okay.
So. Do I know off the top of my head? Yes, I know which one's better. Substitution is better, right? But if we're gonna do this.
No, I meant as far as if we get two algebraic terms and we're doing by parts. Like, is there a way to say, oh, like the exponents, like you do the one with the exponent is higher.
Right.
Or,
so
is there some rule, I guess that's what I'm asking.
The other heuristic, there's lots of little heuristics.
Yeah.
But there is one little heuristic that says that, well, if it could be, if you could choose such that you make u so that du is as simple as possible, then choose that one. Okay.
Okay.
So if we're going to go with that, then what should we choose for u?
X.
Then dv is everything else. So du is dx. It doesn't get any simpler than that. How do we figure out what v is?
It's the antiderivative of dv.
Right. So x plus 3 to negative half dx. Okay, so then, now remember what by parts is. You're trading an antiderivative for two others. So here's one of them we're trading for. Can we do this one? And the answer is yes, we can. So how do we do this one? I didn't follow that. What's that? Okay. It will be that. I do agree with that. But let's be clear. The reason why it will be the case is let's do the substitution, right?
Yeah.
So in the midst of our by parts, we're going to do a substitution. Oh, yeah, it gets great. So w is x plus 3. I can't use u again. Why not?
That would be confusing. That would be way more confusing than it already is.
I'm using u already. So dw then is dx. So that would mean that v is the antiderivative of w to negative half dw. Is this one of the antiderivatives we know?
Yes.
Yes. So this would be w to half over half. Division by half is same as multiplication by 2. So this would be 2 w to half, but w is x plus 3, so x plus 3 to half. So we made it past that hurdle, right? So the right-hand side of by parts is uv minus antiderivative v du. And we have all those pieces now. So x and then 2x plus 3 to half.
The w is really v, correct? From the very first part? Thing.
W is x plus 3.
Of v.
I'm not sure I follow you.
Where'd you get from?
Here? Division by 1/2? Division by a fraction is the same as multiplication by its reciprocal. And then this would be antiderivative 2x plus 3/2, and then dx.
Which means we're going to have to do another substitution.
Yes, but do you observe that it's the same substitution as above?
Oh, yes, I do.
So this would be x times 2, x plus 3/2, and then minus this 2 just hangs out, and then it will be x plus 3 to 3/2, and then divide by 3/2, and then plus c. So this is two different ways to evaluate this antiderivative.
I was like, yeah, I think you said this easier.
Okay, so I'd like to point something out. Isn't there some kind of procedure that we use to evaluate antiderivatives? Yeah, the Riesz procedure, right? The same thing we've been talking about the whole time. Which one comes first? U substitution comes first. This is an exemplar of why U substitution comes first in the Riesz procedure, because when you can do a U substitution, it is usually a simpler conceptual thing than this. It's usually simpler. Because remember this step was a guess. Now I guessed right to make the exposition expedient. But you might have guessed wrong. Right? So it could have been worse than it was. Okay. Another thing I would like to point out before we move to a new topic is the following. Doesn't it feel doing antiderivatives, isn't it kind of like feeling a little bit like guesswork?
Yes.
It's a little bit like guesswork, right? It's not always clear exactly what to do. And here's an example of... Here's an example of there being at least two pretty different ways to do it. And this is in contrast to computing a derivative, right? Now, in context, you might have fond memories of computing a derivative. There's not two ways to do it. Not really, right? It's pretty cut and dry. You just do it. It just goes that way. And maybe you have the sense that it seems weird that it should be this way. Well, it's not a shortcoming in the textbook. It's not a shortcoming in my knowledge of antiderivatives. What this is this is a consequence of a mathematical thing that's happening, and that is that the derivative as an operation has a property called closedness. It's closed, which is a technical term, but you can think basically that it means it's nice. It behaves nicely. The derivative does. But because the antiderivative is the inverse operation, it cannot be closed. So the antiderivative operator is not closed. And this kind of thing, this feeling that there's so much guesswork involved, that is a reflection of the antiderivative being not closed. And by the way, for those of you who might get a real interest in math, not closed does not mean open. Okay. math things are not doors, right? They're not open or closed. Yes?
So on a quiz where we're pressured to do it fast.
Yeah.
How do you go about this?
This way?
Guesswork.
It just is guesswork. So the best way to go about if your question is I want to be as rapid as possible at this. The best way to do it is to do as many examples as possible and always follow the Riesz procedure. And there's really no better way. I promise you, if there was a better way, that's what I would be teaching you.
Okay, so you're going to give us examples with solutions that we practice?
The textbook for the odd exercises doesn't really have solutions, but it has like the correct final answer, but it doesn't have all the steps. But like I said, if you will work out the exercises, I'll check them, and I'll be glad to.
Oh, you mean like working out of the book?
Mm-hmm. Or just, it doesn't have to be from this textbook. You can go get your favorite textbook. And that'd be fine too. Other questions? Okay, so now let's go to something completely different. Any question about this?
Can you get a joke before
that? A joke before that. A joke. Oh, man. I'm going to have to think about that.
It's really okay. We can move on with that.
Okay.
You can give us back like 5 minutes at the end of class.
Okay.
I'd rather go home and see my family.
So now we're in section 8 point whatever.
8 point whatever.
8.2.
Just give it up.
How far are we going?
Today?
No,
12.7.
Yeah, 12 something or other. So this section is called volume and average. Okay. So the first remark is that, so here's a shape from, or part of a shape anyway, from grade school. I'll just do the whole thing. Why not? So here's a shape from grade school. Okay, and if this length right here, that length right there, is R. What's the name of that shape? Circle, right? And it has an area. What's the formula for its area? Pi R squared. And just so you're okay with using that formula in calculus, right, I want you to observe that the red is not a function. It's not a function because it doesn't pass the vertical line test. However, the top half of it is a function. So that means that the area of this shape could be twice the area of this shape, right? And that red is a function. So in principle, we have a calculus formula for its area. It's pi r squared. Okay, now, here's a new shape. Okay, so in this, again we'll say is R, and this height here is H. So this is an entirely new shape to us, and it's in three dimensions. What do you want to call it?
Cylinder.
Oh, cylinder, I think it'll catch on. Cylinder. And then, what's the name that we give for three-dimensional measure? Volume, right? Okay, so then what is the formula for the volume of a cylinder with such measurements? Yes, pi r squared h. Okay, it's literally base times height. Right, what's the area of the base?
Pi
r squared, because it's a circle, right? So base times height. Okay. So now what we're going to do, now you know the volumes of two different kinds of three-dimensional shapes. You know the volumes of cylinders, like this, and you know the volumes of boxes, right? Rectilinear prisms. Okay, you know those, base times width times height. And you also know these volumes. So what we're going to do now is we're going to look at a kind of shape, and we're going to compute its volume in the same way that we, in the same sort of spirit that we use to define the area of shapes that didn't have names. To find the area of a shape that didn't have a name, like a weird shape. So, from, you know, our prior experience with this, we're going to do it. So, this shape is not common enough in the human experience to have a name, but nevertheless it has an area. How do we compute the area of this? An integral, right? And then we end up using the fundamental theorem if we have an antiderivative. But remember what the integral is that you take the region in question, and then we're going to cut it into rectangles. Okay, so we're cutting it into rectangles, so many rectangles. Okay, this particular estimate, is it an overestimate or an underestimate? An overestimate, because I took the rectangles that are over it. Okay, so this is not exact, it's an approximation. How could I make the approximation better?
Smaller rectangles.
Right, more rectangles, make them thinner, smaller. So then, the calculus point of view is that, well, let's just use infinitely many of them. Let's just cut the shape into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles, find the area of each infinitesimal rectangle, and then sum them all up with an integral. That's the calculus point of view. So now we're going to do the same thing with some three-dimensional shapes, except now the parts that we're going to cut them into are going to be cylinders. We're going to cut a shape into infinitely many infinitesimal cylinders, and then find the volume of an individual cylinder, and then sum up the infinitely many infinitesimal volumes with an integral. Okay? So here we go. So let F be continuous and non-negative on A to B. So we've got a function that looks like this, the same function I always draw. That's a plot of F. And now we're going to revolve it around this horizontal axis, which means that we're going to take this red and we're going to rotate it like this. And it's going to sweep out a vase-looking object. Okay, so the top still looks the same, the bottom reflected. And then here's my attempt to make it look three-dimensional. Okay, so it's like a vase. It's something that you could put your, if it was hand sized, you could kind of grab it like this. You take my meaning. So it's solid, and it has a volume in it. It would displace a certain amount of water if you put it in a bucket. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to cut this shape into pieces. And the way we're going to do that is here is a point, X, on the x-axis. So that's a point X. And we've got this green circle that has its center at X. And what we're going to look at this circle. Infinitely close. That's supposed to be an eye, an eyeball, and then the infinity symbol. not an artist, okay? So I'm going to look infinitely close at this circle. And I'm going to realize upon very close inspection that this supposed circle actually turns out to be a cylinder. A very short cylinder, like a tuna can, right? So it's like a coin. It's a cylinder. Okay? And it's turned sideways from the way you may typically think of a cylinder. Okay? So now we want to find the volume of the cylinder in question, which means that we need to know its height and its radius. Let's consider first its radius. So we need to know that measurement right there, that red measurement. So what is its radius? If this is the one that's centered at X,
F of X.
It's F of X. Why? So do you observe that if this was a mobilized diagram, if I could grab it and I was to move this green circle in the middle back and forth, you'd see it, you know, sort of tracing out this shape. And its radius would always be whatever the distance from here to here is. Well, that height is f of x. So the radius of this cylinder is f of x, no matter where you put it for any x. So now, remember, in this picture it looks like a circle, but my claim is that when you look at it really close, it looks like a cylinder. So we're going to call this measurement, this extent, dx. And this is the height of the cylinder, and this is the radius of the cylinder. So what is the volume of this cylinder that we have here in terms of, so its volume would be
pi
r squared h. Yes, pi, and then f of x squared dx. So this volume, this is the volume of one of these infinitesimal cylinders. So then the name we're going to give this is dv. Is the infinitesimal volume of an infinitesimal cylinder. So through this geometric construction, we have found a formula for dv. Now, how do we recover v from dv? Antiderivative. In fact, because we want to know it between a and b, it's the integral. So v is integral from a to b of pi f of x squared dx. And so here is a formula now that you must memorize. But in the end, yeah, I think it's maybe not that hard because you can, I hope, hopefully observe that what we've done is we took this shape that looks like a vase or whatever, and in the end what we actually did is we cut it into little cylinders. And this is the area of the infinitesimal cylinder at position x. So we need to sum them all up. Okay. So now, just to be clear, what this formula is saying. It's saying that suppose that we take this shape a shape obtainable by rotating a function about an axis, then what we're actually doing to compute its volume is we say, okay, we're going to cut the axis into these parts. So one, there, 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 and there. And then we're going to make all of these cylinders. It's kind of hard to draw because I'm not so excellent at drawing, but I hope you can take my meaning when I say, well, we took this solid shape, and then we had, you might imagine, coins of the right size, and we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 such coins of the right size. And we said, well, that's an approximation of it. So we could find the volume of these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cylinders. And that would be an approximation for the volume of the shape in question. And it's not clear from the way I drew it whether or not it'd be an overestimate or an underestimate, but it would be an estimate. How could we make the estimate more accurate? Use finer coins, right? Use finer cylinders. And then the calculus point of view is, just use infinitely many of them. Just go ahead and do it. Okay, that's what this is saying. Okay, and you might think, well, that seems, so on the one hand, I hope that sounds just like doing this. because it is just like doing that. And on the other hand, you might think, well, this sounds a little bit abstract, but I'd like to impress upon you just how general and important this idea is. So in calculus, literally what you do is you take a known thing, a known measurement that you know, like area or volume, and then you cut the object in question into infinitely many infinitesimal of those pieces, each of which you can measure, and then you sum up all of those measurements with an integral. So for example, another thing that we'll get to is we'll take a surface, like your car has a surface, and we want to know what's the surface area. And the way that we'll do that is we'll say, okay, well, the area of a parallelogram is computed like this. And then we'll cut that surface into infinitely many infinitesimal parallelograms, find the area of each individual one, and then sum them up with an integral. So it always is going to go this way. And your life, in fact, is this way, right? Because from my position, several feet away from each of you, you look like a coherent person, each of you. But in fact, if I was to look closely, close enough, what would I see? I see that you're actually composed of a multitude of cells. That's what you're actually composed of. Right? So what I'm saying is that if you look closely at this shape, it's really composed of infinitely many cylinders. And if I was to look even closer at your cells, I would see, oh, actually, your cells are composed of a multitude of atoms. And then if I was to look at your atoms, you'd actually be composed of a multitude of subatomic particles, right? So that's the way physical science and math goes, just like this. Okay, so now let's do some examples. Okay. So, for example, please find the volume of the solid of revolution obtained by revolving y is x plus 1 about the x-axis on the interval 1 to 4. Include a sketch. Okay, well, let's have a look. So, as for the sketch, here's 1 and 4. What does y is x plus 1 look like? Sorry? Yeah, it's linear and sloped up. So 1 here, so like this, and something like this. Okay. So then it's this region right here, this contained region that's going to be rotated around the x-axis. So it's going to be rotated around. And when you do that, it will end up looking. Something like this. And then okay, and a solid this thing. So what do you want to call this?
Lampshade.
Lampshade. A solid lampshade. There actually is a technical name for this. There is one. And if you like movies with CGI in them, or video games, then you may even already know what this is called. Because it's quite common in the rendering of video games and movies. So the name for this shape is a frustum. So when they're modeling CGI in a movie, right? That's a program, and it's performing a great deal of calculus actually, to make it look good. And you only actually compute what's in front of the viewer, but not too far in front of the viewer, because if it's miles and miles away, then you couldn't see it anyway. So this region of this volume of space that's being rendered in the video game or in the movie, this is called the frustum, the viewing frustum. Frustum. And we want to know the volume of this thing. Okay? So its volume is an integral. So what integral? 1 to 4. And then what is being integrated?
Pi.
X
plus 1 squared.
Yes. Very good. So that's the volume. Pi r squared h. It is constant. It's the 3.14 constant thing. Okay, so then how do we go about this?
Well, you can do algebra.
We can. So we can, I think you're saying we could use FOIL.
Yes.
Okay, we could. But there's actually on this exercise an even shorter way to go.
You pull pi out.
You can. The shortest way to go is a substitution.
What?
Yeah? So if u is x plus 1, then du is dx, and u evaluated at 1 is 2, and u evaluated at 4 is 5. Some people want to do algebra. I get that. It's fine. Integral 2 to 5. And then pi u squared du. When you get accustomed enough to doing this, then you won't even do this substitution, right? So in the same sense that at this time, probably if I said what's 2 plus 5, you could just tell me 7. But, you know, grade school children might still say 5, and then 6, 7 count on their fingers, right? Eventually, probably by the end of the semester, this substitution you'll do in your head is what I'm saying. So then this will be pi and then u cubed over 3. So then pi over 3 and then 125. Minus 8. So 117 pi over 3. What is this number? What is the significance of this number? What does that mean?
That's the volume.
The volume of this thing, right?
Yeah.
So this? Because that's the formula from the previous page is integral from a to b of pi f of x squared dx. And this formula was arrived at by cutting the shape in question into cylinders.
So it's volume for anything with cylinders?
I'm sorry?
It's volume for anything with cylinders?
This is the volume of any of a solid of revolution. And this solid is obtained by revolving this line about the axis. And in such shapes, they can be cut, decomposed into infinitely many infinitesimal cylinders.
So when you say revolution, you mean it's just flipping the equation over?
Right. It's taking this and rotating it to get this thing, a thing that looks like this, like a vase or a lampshade. Okay. Another one. So here's a good one. This will be the last one, I guess, for tonight. So I'll get you started on this one, and then I'll write up the end of it for a homework exercise. Okay, so here's a shape, a new shape that we've never heard of ever before. Okay, so here's a new shape that we've never ever heard of. So what do you want to call it? A cone. I think it'll stick. And then this cone has a volume. What is the formula for its volume? It's one third.
Oh, it's one third.
Yeah. It's one third. So it's one third pi r squared h.
Are we going to have to go back to our geometry books and memorize?
Yes, you should know the names and shapes of all the typical grade school shapes. The names and formulas for their volumes.
The grade schools that you're talking about are way more advanced. I think
grade school is anything including up to high school, right? So I just mean like secondary school and before. Yeah, pre university life. Right. Okay, so then I'd like to for you to observe something that is interesting about this formula. There's something, at least, I think you should find peculiar about this formula. What about it? No, nothing peculiar.
Looks good to me. I don't think we need to question.
What if we cover up the one third for a minute? What's that?
The cone. Or, I mean, it's a cylinder.
That's the volume for a cylinder.
Right.
So what that means is that if you were to take this as the base of a cylinder and make a cylinder that's exactly the same height as the cone, then you could. If you had a solid such cylinder, then you could construct three such cones from it. So if you were to take such a cylinder and then remove such a cone out of it, and then you can imagine a cone minus a cylinder minus that cone, there's still enough material to make two more of those.
See, that's what I don't. That doesn't make sense to me.
But it is a fact.
I believe it's so, but.
And we're gonna prove that this is a fact because we're going to prove that this formula is correct. Okay? It's going to be really great. Okay. So, what we need is we need to look at this shape as a we need to organize it so it will be the volume of revolution for something. So we can revolve something. So what do you think we should revolve?
A line.
It's going to have to be a line, right? Mm-hmm. It can't be curvy because the sides of the cone aren't curvy. So it'd have to be a line. And it has to cross the x-axis, right? So I could put it like right here. I could do that. But if we're going to make it cross the x-axis, let's make it cross the x-axis in the most convenient spot at the origin, which is to say we need a line that goes through the x-axis. But since we want to make it go through it at the most convenient spot, that means that let's make it go through the origin. Okay. So what's this interval going to be?
Zero
to h, right? Why do we want this to be zero to h?
That's
the height of the cylinder, right? So if this is zero, then this one over here needs to be h. If we do that, then that means that this will have measurement h. Okay, and what do we need this measurement to be?
R.
We need it to be r. So what we need, that's the things that we need. So as a consequence of this, we need to find the equation for that red line. We know that it has to go through the origin, and we know that it has to fit this h and this r. Right? So then any line could be written as y is mx plus b, right? Any sloped line can be written as y is mx plus b. So from college algebra, what's the meaning of the B? It's the y-intercept. So what is B for us?
Zero.
So B is zero. And what is the meaning of M? Slope. So I claim that you should just be able to look at our picture and tell me what the slope is. When you're in college algebra, you say slope is blank over blank.
Oh, right over
r. Okay.
So r over h.
So r over h.
Oh, you said that.
Oh, so I just didn't hear it. So r over h. That sound? I don't know what it is. The sound. Well, we're nearly there now. So what is the formula then of this line?
Y equals r over h.
Right. So this is y is r over h x, and then plus zero. Right. That's the plus b. So then, we're going to take this now, and we're going to revolve it around the axis. Okay, so we're going to take that. So do you observe that this would sweep out this cone, mm-hmm. turn sideways? So then what is, according to our previous reckoning, then what is the formula for that when you do this? So not this. This is what we must finish with. We can't argue from here. We have to argue to here.
Zero to h.
Zero to h. 0 to h, and then what?
1 third cos.
No, that's starting from here.
I know, I'm like, I don't know.
What is it? Is the formula from the from 2 pages ago. We have to use this formula.
Okay, so pi.
Pi.
R over hx.
Almost, yeah, r over h x
squared.
This thing squared.
Dx.
Dx. And so now, for homework. For homework, you're going to, I want you to evaluate this. And what are you supposed to get? How will you know that you got the right answer?
We'll get 1 third pi
squared. You must get 1 third pi r squared h. And then when you have shown that you've gotten this, then you've done it.
You win.
Yes, and you will have, for yourself, come up with the formula for the volume of a cone. Okay, so have a nice Tuesday.